Good afternoon, everybody. Now we have a Mike Slice. Mike Slice is partner and managing director of Slice Berman & Partner. He is also professor at the Technische Universität in Berlin, where he is chair of conceptual and structural design. He is an innovator in engineering education as well as an extraordinary designer of singular buildings, bridges, tower, and roof, such as the Wanda Metropolitano Stadio roof in Madrid, and the Tinkau Bridge in Hong Kong. He has a lot of awards, specific awards in different work, and also a gold medal by the Institution of Structural Engineers at London. Well, I think we want to listen.
Help is arriving. Mijadla is lava in el desktop. No, it's lava in el desktop. Thank you. Pepa, thank you very much for inviting me. Happy to be here and to talk about infralightweight concrete. So I have changed the title with the permission of Pepa Casineo, so I hope that is okay. It's about architecture, it's about engineering, it's about concrete, but mainly it's about sustainable construction, what I want to talk about. Perhaps 20 years ago, no one really talked about sustainability, but today there is a paradigm change. Sustainability is absolutely important because we are becoming too many. Do you know by how many the world population grows every year? Do you have an idea? Any guesses? Sorry? No, that's a bit too much, but the world population grows, I just read it, by 80 million a year. Germany is about 80 million. So if we want to build for the next 80 million in 2019, we would have to rebuild Germany. If we want to have them at my level of quality of life, we would have to build Germany every year for the years to come. Imagine, that's not possible. So we are in trouble, aren't we? And I think it's obvious that we have to do something, and what we can do is save material, built with less material, and that means lightweight construction. Lightweight construction means less minimizing material, saving resources. So it's obvious that we have to build with less material, but also we have to save energy, at least in countries like Germany. I'm talking about within the German context, really. We use a lot of energy for heating, so we have to save energy, heat less, be more efficient, and we need more insulation. There's a lot of insulation issues in Germany these days, but that is contradicting the issue of material, because insulation needs a lot of material. So this is a bit of a contradicting issue, and that is something that I think affects us all. It affects building architecture. Engineering has to be completely different these days, and this is what interests me very much. It took me a while. I found the word sustainability, I found it very boring. I couldn't hear it anymore. But today I think it's absolutely necessary to think about it. So what I want to give you within the next half hour, I don't think I'll talk for 1 hour, is food for thought and perhaps also food for the discussion we'll have later. The title of this conference is Where Do We Come From? Where Are We Going? As I said, architecture, engineering, concrete, and this is what I want to talk about, mainly about infralightweight concrete, which is load-bearing insulation, a very simple approach to building, simple building. It has got to do with sustainability, but it also has its drawbacks. So I want to circle this theme. I want to concentrate in the middle of my talk on infralightweight concrete, but I'll give you a bit of a lengthy introduction because there is where do we come from? And this is what I ask myself when I work as an engineer. And I come from Schleich and Bergermann. These are the founders of our office. I come from Schleich, Bergermann and Partner. This is where I work. And these are the two who started the office in 1980. We took over, the next generation took over in 2002, and today we have offices, well, not really all over the world, but you see in several places around the world, we have grown from 50 in 2002 to about 200 today, and we are also six partners now, so from two to six and also growing. So this is where I come from, person-wise, but where do I come from structure-wise? One of the roots, the main roots of our office is certainly the roof, the cable net, lightweight roof of the Olympic Stadium in Munich. My father was the project engineer working at the time in Leonhard Andre's office. And I think this is a sustainable project also in the sense that it left a lasting impact. It changed the image of Germany, the Nazi Germany, the heavy fascist German architecture changed. All of a sudden it became the lightweight, open, happy German architecture in a way. That was a very big change, I think. And ever since then in our office we have built numerous stadium projects, lightweight roofs all over the world, not all of them sustainable, but we are working on it. And as Pepa has said, this is one of the most recent projects that we finished. For me it's still the Peneta, but it should be called Wanda with Metropolitana. I was there at the opening and it was impressive. I've never seen so many flags in my life. This is all flags of Atletico. was wild. So this is one of the roots I come from. Another root is the issue of solar thermal power plants, and this is a Spanish project in Manzanares, the first and only solar updraft tower, a solar chimney you can call it, with the idea of having a greenhouse. The sun heats the air under the greenhouse, the air gets warm, it wants to go up, it wants to rise, it finds a chimney, speed goes up, you create artificial wind, and this artificial wind moves the turbine and produces energy. Another route of our office, and ever since then we have built numerous solar thermal power plants. I come back to that in a while. And we continue actually with the idea, even though it has not been built yet, of the solar chimney. We combine it now with PV, photovoltaics, because this is the future. It's very efficient, it's very economic, but you cannot store it well. But together with the solar chimney that can produce energy 24 hours, I think that would be a good mix, a good combination. So another route that we follow, this is where I come from, this is where I go to. And finally, bridges. The Hooghly Bridge, the Calcutta Cable State Bridge, it was the longest in the world some 25 years ago. The first cable state bridge with a composite deck, all riveted, because at the time in Calcutta they could not weld steel, they could not bolt steel, so they riveted the entire bridge. And that shows that indigenous building with local labor, local material, local construction methods is possible. And ever since then we have built bridges all over the world, mainly lightweight bridges. And now comes a picture that I have added for Bill Addis just in real time. This is a very recent little bridge that we have finished, and the model was built with an orange net from the local supermarket. So it was not actually done for static analysis, but it was done for form finding. Now it's a stressed cable net model, and these orange nets, they are actually quadrangular, you say. They don't have diagonals, they don't have triangles, so they deform, and they deform so that the stresses can be seen, the principal forces in the membrane or in the shell can be seen. This is actually a model that pushes the net upwards, so it's a little bent timber plate that pushes the net upwards, and this timber plate, which is the walkway of the bridge and that presses the bridge up like the inverse life load, no, produces tension. And later, if you put the life load in the correct way, you would get the same geometry, the same shape, but in compression. So we built this little bridge, and this is how it looked when it was built. 28 meters span, 20 millimeter thickness, all stainless steel, and we were very happy, lucky, because the owner of this area is the owner of Trumpf. They build lasers. They build lasers to cut steel. So it was comparatively easy to convince them to use their lasers to cut in the holes into the steel, like in our orange net. So this is how this little footbridge looks from underneath. Certainly not the most economic way to build a footbridge, but in a way, it shows how lightweight we can build these days. So this is, in relation, it would be 6 times thinner than an eggshell. At the university, I also teach and research at the Technische Universität Berlin, at TU Berlin. We're also working in the field of lightweight structures. And what you see here is an old bridge. It was built more than 10 years ago. It's the first carbon fiber stress ribbon bridge. It's 13 meters span and 1 millimeter structural height. It's a carbon fiber band on which concrete plates were placed as the walkway, but actually the load-bearing structure is just a very thin carbon fiber ribbon, because carbon fiber has some advantages. It can be stressed very highly, so it can compete with high-strength steel, but it doesn't corrode and there's no fatigue. And these are certainly interesting properties that we also want to use for prefabricated pre- or post-tensioned beams that can be placed on abutments that can be cast together to form integral frame bridges that can be built fast and that are most likely very durable because carbon fiber has no fatigue and no corrosion issues. So you need less concrete cover, the bridges can be lighter, you save material, and in the end these bridges could even look nice and add to Baukultur, as we call it in Germany. So this is what we work on at the university. Together with DSI, we are developing post-tensioning systems. We have tested small beams already. This is always how you start, with the small beams. In January, we want to build a 1-to-2 model, 20 meter beams, and then hopefully soon we'll have the first bridges with about 40 meter span, but all integral, because we were talking about prefabricated elements. The problem I think of prefabrication is all the joints and bearings, I don't like them. But if you can make it integral, then there's nothing wrong with prefabrication. Lightweight structures are definitely nothing new. If you want to know more about this structure, ask Pepa, she's an expert in Felix Candela's work. But this is, I think, the aim, to minimize the use of material, to really build lightweight structures. And Candela has shown that with his Xochimilco shell of only 40 millimeter thickness. But you find it all over the place. If you go to Chicago and if you look at 910 Lakeshore Drive, these famous apartments by Ludwig Mies van der Rohe, they're very lightweight. Look at the right picture. This is steel framed. There's not even a concrete elevator shaft. It's very lightweight, very transparent, very minimized. So it would be nice if we could build this way today. But here the trouble starts, because if you go into one of these apartments, this is the famous curtain wall facade. You see Lake Michigan reflected in the facade. And if you go inside the building, inside one of these apartments, you see that this is a steel frame that is directly going through the facade from the inside to the outside. No thermal cut. It's from the building physics point of view, this type of lightweight building is naive, you know, because you waste a lot of heating energy with these buildings. So perhaps we can soon build again like that, because imagine for a moment, if the energy we have had was cheap, clean, and renewable. If it was solar energy, we could build like that. We could use the solar energy to produce the steel or the concrete, and we could heat, use waste heating energy in a way because it's free, clean, and renewable. So I'm very much convinced that sooner or later our energy, our electricity will come from the deserts, in the case of Europe, from the deserts of Africa, or from the deserts south of Madrid, if you want. I'm very convinced that Spain has a big future in solar thermal energy. But until then, we have to do something, because right now there isn't, this energy is not available. I'm convinced that this will come soon, but what do we do until then? Well, we need to insulate. We cannot build like Mies. We can also not build like these typical German Berlin houses are built, you know, with very heavy walls that have some thermal inertia, but this is also waste. We have to wait until we get this type of solar energy, and until then we need to insulate. On the left side, I think I gave a talk here about 10 years ago about infralightweight concrete, and this is kind of an update story, so to say. And I'll introduce you now to infralightweight concrete, showing you first what the alternatives are. And on the left side, you see a typical Swiss chalet in the Swiss mountains. You look at the heavy timber corner here and the stone corner, but the closer you look, the more you see that this is only the corner, but the rest is very thin panels of timber, and behind it there's rock wool. And here this is also only azulejos, no? And behind it there is also styrofoam as insulation. Well, the Swiss at least cheat in a nice way, you know, very stylish. While this is on the right side, you see the German way of insulating a house. This is a little less, well, it's very direct, let's put it this way. And you also see the waste that is produced already during construction, all this plastic waste. And this is because the law says you have to insulate your house. And this is what is done. You see that all over Germany. The temperatures are so low that you really have to insulate to save energy, to save heating energy. And there's all these systems that produce this insulation, but they're layered. They're made of 7, 8, 9 layers of different materials, glass fiber nets and epoxy glue and styrofoam and plaster and paint and all that. And the trouble I see there is that once you reach the end of life, if you look at the whole life cycle of such buildings, if you tear this down, you have a lot of toxic waste that you cannot use, that you cannot recycle. That really seems to me a problem. Also, since they're so nicely insulated, the surface gets very cold at night, and then in the morning you get condensation. Therefore, you have to put a lot of fungicides in it. I was told that the German cities have a higher fungicide concentration in the ground than the country where agriculture is. But once the fungicide is washed out, then this might happen. You know, you get fungus and you get algae, and the birds come. And this is, and then also, if you knock at these houses, you know, they don't sound like this. They sound hollow, and I don't like a house that sounds hollow. And this is why we thought perhaps we can work with lightweight concrete, that is insulating. And lightweight concrete is a very old way of building. You all know that the Pantheon is a very early lightweight building, but it was not built of lightweight concrete to insulate, to be frank. But there's 2,000 years of experience, 3,000 years of engineering in that field, if you want. And recently, especially in Switzerland, there is a set of lightweight concrete houses that were just built for this reason. Lightweight, fair-faced concrete houses, all concrete houses that used lightweight concrete. You can see that here, 1,200 kilos per cubic meter, 900 kilos per cubic meter, in order to make the concrete lightweight and insulating, no additional insulation. And that, I thought, was a good way to start. And we wanted to make it lighter than lightweight concrete. This is from the Eurocode, and all you need to read is what you see here. Lightweight concrete must lightweight concrete is between 800 and 2,000 kilos per cubic meter. But what is, how do you call it when it's lighter than 800 kilos? Well, we call it infralightweight. Like you have infrared and ultraviolet, we said, why not call it infralightweight? No? Because it's below lightweight. So we started experimenting with concretes that are lighter than 800 kilos per cubic meter, that are not covered by the coats, but that promised, you know, to even more insulation. That is a bit the idea. And we didn't have to go far, you know. We saw the experience from our Swiss colleagues. All you need is lightweight aggregates, inflated glass. No, wait a second. I need to go back. Inflated glass or inflated clay. How do you call this in Spain? These materials. Arlita, no? So Arlita is available. You can start experimenting right now, and then you need a lot of air bubbles in the concrete, and that's it. And this is how we started about 12 years ago, and the first results were awful. Now we made our test cubes. The Arlita was all up there, and the concrete, the cement was down here. You know, full separation. That was not exactly the idea, because I started as a professor coming from the world of lightweight structures, not of lightweight concrete. I didn't have much experience in concrete, really. But sooner or later it worked, you know, and in the end we came up with mixes that were rather homogeneous, where the bubbles stayed where they are supposed to stay. And then after actually only a couple of months of research, we built the first house in Berlin of infralightweight concrete, of a concrete that weighs about 800 kilos. And you see, this is a 10 meter wall, 50 centimeter thickness, and no additional insulation. Colleagues told me, Mike, that's a risk you're building with the mortar, and mortar does not last so long, but this is the proof this house has now survived the first 12 years without showing any sign of trouble, so to say. So it works. Inside it looks like that. I mean, you have to like lightweight fair-face concrete, yes, but you could also paint it if you don't like the gray. We use three pane windows, three glass panes, very efficient. I was told to put some heating at the ground, because these 6 meter windows would cause falling cold air, but it's not the case. If you work with three pane glass, there is no trouble anymore, and we never use this heating system. But you see, the facade goes straight to the concrete, the windows go straight to the concrete. Very simple construction. Construction becomes easy. And that also showed us that it's not enough. Now I could talk about concrete, engineering, architecture. It's not enough to just develop a mix and then hope that everyone uses it. It's better to talk to the architects, to work together. So it's, as Carmen Andrade says, it's the material first, then it's the engineers who do the structure, and then the architects. Only if we work together and look at the potential of something different or slightly new, then results can come up. So the idea was basically to say, well, in the beginning, we just built the outer walls of infralightweight concrete. The inner ceilings and walls, they can be of normal concrete, they can store heat, they can be thermally inert. The roof, well, as long as we don't have this concrete in bending, we still have to insulate it. So this was basically the idea of building houses like that. And we have done research for the last 12 years. Here you see a typical detail. The normal reinforcement of the concrete slab, normal concrete, that is this area here. And since we didn't really know if this concrete works nice in bending, if you can really fix the wall to the slab, we said, why don't we support it like we would support a slab on a brick wall? So it's very centrally supported. We have some additional foam glass here as insulation, because here we have less infralightweight concrete. We knew already that this concrete is very porous, so it takes a lot of humidity. When it rains, it soaks up the water. So we worked, you see, with glass fiber reinforcement. And that, actually, you don't need a lot of reinforcement in a wall. It's more for shrinkage cracks, or if you have a window, then you need to have a little bending. But I don't like glass fiber reinforcement too much, because this is, again, plastic, and we wanted to have a house without plastic, so But anyway, it worked, and it is a solution to work with glass fiber reinforcement or with basalt reinforcement or whatever. And as I said, for the last 10 years we have done research. That's the nice thing about being catedratico. You have lots of PhD students, well, in general, in theory at least, and many bachelor and master students, and we could do lots of different exercises, creep and shrinkage, compression strength, modulus of elasticity, how does it behave when you get icing or heat. We put it in an oven. We did, here you see the heating of the material, how does it behave at 1,000 degrees, what different materials can you use, which mix is the most stable. We did everything at the level of bachelor and master's thesis, and we also have now two PhD theses on this subject. One is in the field of bending, because as I said, you know, you always have a window, you have a cantilever for a balcony, and there you get bending, and we wanted to see how these very lightweight concretes behave under bending. You have to know how the bond is, bonding stresses, you have to know how cracking works, and you have to see how it fails. And the result of this PhD thesis was tables for dimensioning this concrete. So this is now very well understood, and what's interesting is that this concrete does not behave like normal concrete, it behaves more like ultra-high performance concrete, very high strength concrete. It's basically brittle, so it's basically linear, there's no plastic deformation, and therefore, as you can see here, if you dimension the section, you work with a triangular stress distribution. Perhaps I should have known, now I know at least. And then we started looking at structural details. At least in Germany, you cannot normally build a balcony plate and directly connect it to the building, because that would cause terrible heat or cold temperature transfer. But if your cantilever, if your balcony plate is insulating material, there's no problem with connecting it directly to the inside floor slab. So what you see here on the left, that would be normal concrete inside. This could be a prefabricated balcony. So you concrete the wall, you place the prefabricated balcony plate, and then you cast the concrete off the normal slab. And then we did all kinds of exercises together with our colleagues in building physics to see how the heat transfer is. Naturally, at this location here, you get a little trouble that you always get. But we could show that such connections are possible without any separation between the slab, the cantilever, and the wall, or the interior slab. And then you can go further, you can build Gaudi in a way. You know, the more balcony you have, the better is your insulation. So this is, again, a change of thinking, and that I think was very interesting in our collaboration with architects, because they started thinking on how to use this new material. We worked with Regine Leibinger, who was professor at the TU Berlin at that time, and it was a very interesting joint research project between engineers and architects. And you can see that such a detail naturally also works well. You cannot immediately see, but these colors are there to illustrate that insulation works nicely. We made this concrete self-compacting. We heard about Reckli today, so this is also Reckli formwork. So all kinds of surfaces can be made, or if you cut the concrete, you see all the little dots of the aggregates. So all this is exercises that we did. By the way, this is our lab in Berlin, the 180-meter Peter Behrens Halle in the old factory of AEG. So should you ever come to Berlin, come visit us and look at this piece, nice piece of architecture. We wrote, naturally, lots of papers. This is a German article, but here's the translation in English: infra-lightweight concrete ready for practice. We dared to say that last year, because after 10 years, I think the risk of using something that is a bit novel is minimum. And I think in Ace, the Ace magazine, this will be published in Spanish in a short time also. So the first house was built 10 years ago. We didn't really dare building more until we knew more about this concrete. But last year we started with this building in Berlin. It's a small one, but it's with a public client, and public clients are difficult, you know, because they want all the certificates that are required by law, naturally. So we found a client in Berlin Lichtenberg, one of the areas of Berlin, who was very eager to try something new, and this is a youth center or youth and family center where people gather, and pop architects worked with us, and again it was this combination, this working together from the start, concrete engineer and architect, that led to this result of a concrete building, very simple, but again all walls are infra lightweight concrete, but also some cantilevers here, so we had to use our experience with infra lightweight concrete in bending. Here, see here this, the cantilevering roof, because this should not be normal concrete, otherwise we have the trouble again with heat transfer. And in Germany, if you build something that is not covered by the code, you need to have a special permit. And in order to get the special permit, you have to do lots of tests and experiments. And this is what we did here. We had to test simple beams. We had to test cantilevers, six of them on a way. Is it here? Cantilever roof, two of them, projecting roof, two beams, three. We tested all that, and that gave us a lot of additional insight. So this is again in our lab, all the infralightweight beams that we tested. And well, we have seen many of these pictures, but it showed to us that, you know, this concrete works. You get the typical shear failure. If you wanted to fail in shear, you get typical failure in bending, if you want to have it fail in bending. So here's the normal concrete, here's the infralightweight concrete, and this is also infralightweight concrete. And it acts not in a very brittle way, actually, because the reinforcement helps. So we could prove it works. We also wanted to see how self-compacting it really is, because if you build windows, you want the concrete to really go underneath here. This is the trouble, and usually you put in a pipe and fill it in here, but since this concrete is now self-compacted, it really float below the window. This is a demonstrator wall that we built again in our lab. All that was required by the client, but fortunately also paid for it. We also thought, what happens if the guy with the windows comes? If the windows are placed, and the first thing the window people say, well, we don't know this concrete, so we cannot use our usual dowels, and we start claiming. So we asked Hilti and Fischer, and they tested their dowels. So this is a typical dowel pull-out test. You see here, this is the hole of the dowel, and you see how big the cone area is. So this concrete is comparatively good for it. Works nice with dowels. So building started. Here we did not use glass fiber reinforcement. We worked with galvanized reinforcement, which still is expensive, but I think better than glass fiber reinforcement. You cannot pump this lightweight concrete, because when you pump, there's pressure, and if there's pressure, the water of the concrete gets pressed into the clay aggregates, and then the concrete might get stuck in the tube. So you use these tubes to concrete. This is concreting, and then you can see the walls here. Just looks like a normal building, 50 centimeter walls, and nothing else will happen to it. What you also see here is the levels of concreting. Since it's self-compacting, we do not compact it additionally. So, and you see the details here. Very nice surface, looks like normal concrete, but if you put it in water, it would swim. It's only 800 kilos. That's a problem if you do test tubes. These test tubes always swim, so you have to put something on top of it. And this is the almost finished building a few weeks ago, all done with lightweight concrete. Again, you see the levels of pouring the concrete, but the architect likes that. So it's heavy, it's 50 centimeters of concrete, but no additional insulation. With Marco Leibinger Architects, that's the B&L here, we wanted build a 10-story house now. This is, should be possible with this concrete. And again, of as said before, we talked about it before, of prefabricated elements. So this would be conventional concrete slabs with precast wall elements from bottom to top, and in between only windows or doors. So see this element? This element just repeats. You can put it this way, you can put it this way, you can put it upside down. So it would always would be the same precast element that is used over and over again. Berlin grows with about 50,000 people a year, so there's a lot of need for fast building, and this could be fast building because it's prefabricated and it's only concrete, nothing else, no painting, no insulation. That could become a model for fast building. So this is how these apartments would look. That's the architect's view. Again, collaboration from the start, using a new material and thinking of how to build with small buildings. You can use the cubes, you can cast the concrete in situ, but if it should go fast and if it's higher, then you work with precast elements. Supermarkets. Like the oranges I bought them at Rewe, and I found out that Rewe, German supermarket, builds supermarkets for about 300 to 400 million euros a year. And so why not make these supermarkets with infra lightweight concrete? You could use timber, because timber is perhaps the best as far as carbon footprint goes and as far as sustainability goes. So why not use timber beams for the roof, but then make all the walls out of infralightweight concrete? So there was a master thesis on that, and we are discussing with the supermarket chain if we do the first test one. And here, some Spanish architects called Lazo de la Vega y Enguita started an infralightweight concrete for a German artist in Germany, but the architecture comes from Spain, so this would also be an all infralightweight concrete building that is designed here. Actually, this the facade here would be a carbon fiber facade, a carbon highly stressed carbon fiber net with glass on top. So a very innovative experimental house that will also hopefully be built soon. So this is the status. Normal infralightweight concrete can be built. I'll show you 10 slides now on the research that we continue to do quickly. We are working with layered walls. We are thinking about, you see this here, active thermal insulation by integrated capillary tube mats. That means you can put in tubes here and you can use the groundwater, which in Germany is always at 10 degrees. So if it's minus 10 degrees in winter, you just pump groundwater through the outer layer of the wall and produce additional insulation, so you can build with thinner walls. You can have stronger outer elements. This would be 800 kilos, but the core would be 500 kilo lightweight concrete. So we tested all kinds of combinations and thought what is best, and we are building it. We are building it as beams and see how is the bonding between the 800 and the 500 kilo concrete. We are building walls and load them. How does a wall fail? Very strange failure modes. There's very little on walls, testing walls, because concrete walls are usually so hard to test because the loads are very high. So I found it surprising that there's a lot on brick walls, but very little on real size, one-to-one size concrete walls. Very strange failure modes. You see this Ojalde-like spalling off. We are testing now how details would look in this case if we had these layered walls and how we would connect the normal slab. So then we could, you know, we can go down to 45, we can go down to 40, we make them smaller and smaller again. And we get research funding by the local investors, because the local investors, they need to build houses very fast. So we are developing such multi-layer elements for housing projects in Berlin. There is a website, www.infraleichtbeton.de, but it's also in English, so if you can look it up in English. There's a book, unfortunately in German only, Infraleichtbeton, together with Regine Leibinger, the architect that we work together. So the architects, they're very good in in putting results together. You know, we engineers, we can do all kinds of graphs and academic papers, but together with the architect, we made a book, and that's nice. You know, so I like that. So until the energy comes from the desert, until it's free and clean and cheap, we have to work with such temporary solutions as infra-lightweight concrete or the insulation materials that you have seen. Concrete is not perfect, the CO2 footprint is terrible. An advantage of infra-lightweight concrete is that carbonation is very fast. I mean, if we heard about it also from Carmen this morning, carbonation goes to 1 or 2 centimeters. An infra-lightweight wall, I think, would be carbonated all the way through, all the 50 centimeters through within a few years. That means it takes all the CO2, well, not all of it, but a great part of the CO2 back. So infra-lightweight concrete, you know, produces a lot of CO2 during fabrication, but it takes a considerable amount back during its life. So carbonation in that case is even advantageous. We just have to think about good reinforcement to deal with it. Anyways, I show this because it's not built yet, and I want to show you this because that is built already. There is very proven technology in the field of solar thermal power plants. These are trough collectors. It's parabolic mirrors that heat a medium, oil or molten salt or even steam, in a tube that you cannot see here yet because it's under construction, but here are the tubes. And such solar thermal power plants exist. Or look at this one. This is just thousands of mirrors that focus on one.